I'm actually Zoroastrian. I was just wondering, what's the relationship like between Hindus and Zoroastrians in India?
Fantastic. Okay, it's a beautiful question. Nice to explore this. Let me give some background to Zoroastrianism, because this is something very interesting, very close to my heart. There are some people and some religions that are very close to my heart. I feel tremendous affinity for them. And Zoroastrianism is one of the best religions I've come across. You see, Zoroastrianism started before the Hebrew tradition. So it is even before, more ancient than Judaism. In the Middle East, the ancient religion was Zoroastrianism. Here you see, if you like, this the great Zarathustra, you know, trying to make sense of the world and coming up with, if you like, his own prescription of how to understand reality. So there is a tremendous, if you like, coherence with Hinduism and Zoroastrianism, because these are the most ancient religions in the world, both of them. And the Zoroastrian books are called Gathas, they are called Vedas. And if you look at some of the etymology, some of the wordings, you can see a tremendous link, very ancient link between Zoroastrianism and Hinduism. Okay. Now what is the link of, how do Hindus relate to Zoroastrianism? I'll tell you. This is a very interesting question. As I said, the Hindus have been very open-minded. They always welcome people of other religion to come and live with them. Not to influence, not to convert them, but to come and live with them and practice their own religion without any interference. And this is a very beautiful story. It's a lovely story. I think, about, I don't know the exact years, but a few hundred years back, the Muslim invasion in the Middle East meant that they were going to wipe out the Zoroastrians, kill or convert them. This is a very ancient story. So all the Zoroastrians were told, either we kill you or you convert to Islam, otherwise you are off, you are going to be killed. This is the reality. And a few shiploads of Zoroastrians, I don't know how many, this is a real historic fact, few shiploads of Zoroastrians left Iran and started to travel east. And they ended up in Gujarat, Surat. It's a wonderful story to explore, really you must explore. And the king of India, the king in Gujarat, they said, oh, who are you? Why are you here? And to convince the king, there was a young lady in that Zoroastrian kind of delegation who said, I'll show you what we are all about. She said, can you bring some milk and some sugar? And they said, yes. She said, now drink the milk on its own. It's fine. Now she said, put sugar in the milk and stir it and now drink it. Oh, it tastes better, said the king. This is exactly what we are. If you like, we want to merge with you, like sugar into milk. We produce a much better kind of civilization. We give our sweetness into your system and produce a better kind of relationship. This is how we'll merge within your own society without interfering, but enhancing you. This is a beautiful, real story. And the king said, fine, you're welcome to stay. And the Zoroastrians settled down. And because they were settled down in Gujarat, they picked up Gujarati. Most of Zoroastrians I come across in London speak fluent Gujarati. They love Gujarati food, they adopted all the Gujarati methods, but still maintained their religion very, very, you know, steadfastly. There's a Zoroastrian center in Rainer's Lane, and I interact very closely with all the Zoroastrian community, and I'm very well known to the main priest in London, Rusi Berdwaj, and so I interact with them all the time. And if you like, one of the best examples of how Zoroastrianism has, and they have never interfered with the politics of India. In fact, it's just one of the smallest populations in the world, Zoroastrian poly, very tiny. In fact, they are struggling to survive because their population is so small. They have difficulty in finding partners, married partners. But this very tiny community is offering the greatest philanthropic, contribution to India. I don't know the percentage, but for a tiny percentage of this population, the amount of contribution they are making towards the greater good of India is unparalleled. No other community does it. No Gujarati. We all want to put the money in the back of pocket and sit on it. The Zoroastrians contribute. I'll give you an example. The best example. You know, Jamsetji Tata, he was one of the founders of the Tata Empire, was strongly, very philanthropically oriented gentleman. He started most of this kind of major innovation, institute of research. This was set up by the Tata family. And the Tata family still continues to be a major contributor. Look, they are AAA as far as the integrity is concerned. They don't compromise. They are not corrupt. And yet, I'm told by the chief priest in London, 70% of the profit of Tata goes for philanthropic activity, for the betterment of greater good. When I hear things like that, I say, that king in Surat to invite the Zoroastrians to stay has done a great service to India and to the Zoroastrian community. Whenever I go to some interfaith meeting, the Zoroastrian speaker, before he stands up, he'll say, Jay, do you know why we're alive, why we are still Zoroastrian? Because of you chaps, Gujaratis. I say, yes, we know. We are very grateful. But you repaid us tenfold. You already repaid us tenfold. And that is why you will see the Zoroastrian and the Hindu community fit extremely well. They're mixed with us in every sense. Again, one of the great features of the Zoroastrian community, I must say these things, is the sense of humor. You don't know how tremendous sense of humor they've developed. But sense of humor is very visible. Their philanthropic activity is very visible. And there is no way I've seen any issue between Hindus and Zoroastrians in India or outside. In fact, outside, we are even closer. So whenever I interact with the Zoroastrian community at interfaith meetings, we kind of immediately link up with each other. We relate to each other very well.